Hello, and welcome to another edition of UDC Forum. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber, Director for the Humanities at the University of the District of Columbia Community College, and your host. My guest on this edition of UDC Forum is Dr. Karsonya Whitehead, Professor of Communication and African and African American Studies in the Department of Communications at Loyola University, Maryland, and the founding executive director of the Emily Frances Davis Center for Education, Research, and Culture. She is author of three books, one of which is the primary topic of this discussion, Notes from a Colored Girl, The Civil War Pocket Diaries of Emily Frances Davis, which received both the 2015 Darlene Clark Hine Book Award from the Organization of American Historians and the 2014 Letitia Woods Brown Book Award from the Association of Black Women Historians. Dr. Whitehead is also the author of Letters to My Black Sons, Raising Boys in a Post-Racial America, and Sparking the Genius, the Carter G. Woodson Lecture. In addition, Dr. Whitehead is the co-editor of Rethinking Emily Frances Davis, Lesson Plans for Teaching Her Civil War Pocket Diaries. She is a K-12 master teacher in African American history, an award-winning curriculum writer, lesson plan developer, Baltimore City Middle School teacher, Maryland History Teacher of the Year Award winner, and a three-time New York Emmy-nominated documentary filmmaker. Welcome.
Thank you so much.
That is a long list of accomplishments, and you certainly are very qualified and capable. How did you make the transition from K to 12 to the academy?
Well, I actually started off as a documentary filmmaker. I was in New York, and I worked with both MTV and PBS for 10 years, first doing television producing, and then I started making historical documentaries. From there, when we were kind of at the end of our time in New York after 9/11, and I did my film Twin Towers, my husband is a missionary, and he felt called to Baltimore City to actually launch a feeding ministry for men who were temporarily experiencing homelessness. So when we moved down from New York to Baltimore, I had two babies, and I decided I wanted to be a school teacher. I wanted to take all the information I had learned as a history major and teach social studies. I mean, this notion that our young people can't become who they're supposed to be if they don't know where they've come from. And so I became a social studies teacher. I was teaching at an inner city public school, which was very difficult and very challenging, but I loved it. I loved having that opportunity to speak into the minds and hearts and spirits and soul of young people. I remember the first day I walked in there, and I was calling them geniuses. And my principal said, he pulled me aside and he said, I want to remind you that you are not teaching geniuses. I said, well, they'll be geniuses when I get finished with them. And I'm so happy that those students that I taught in middle school, 95% of them have graduated from college today. That they came from this very challenged middle school, but they have gone on to greatness. They were giants who just hadn't grown up yet. But after teaching for 4 years, I received some diaries in the mail from a very good friend of mine, copies of diaries. She was working at the Historical Society of Pennsylvania, and she had found these diaries in the basement, and they were marked to go in the trash. She made copies of them, sent them to me, and when I was reading through them, and I discovered that Emily Frances Davis was a black woman, a freeborn black woman, I made the decision then to quit my job as a school teacher and go back and get my PhD. And I moved from there into being tenure track and now tenured at Loyola University, Maryland.
That's quite interesting. I like the fact when you were talking to the students initially early on in your teaching career that you were addressing them in that manner. Were you surprised when the principal was not on board with that?
I was a little surprised, and I think the more time I spent in the system, I began to understand. I did not know what it meant to be a teacher. I was a non-traditional teacher. I'd come through a certification program where they taught you how to teach in one summer. So I didn't understand what that meant. But I did know and I did believe that we have to speak genius into our children. We have to do what Carter G. Woodson said. We have to spark the genius. We have to remind them that the torch is theirs. And even though they can't see the genius, our job as teachers and parents and mentors and aunts and uncles, we have to sing the genius for them. And we have to speak it over them. And we have to get inside of them and kind of coax it out of them.
How are you using the primary sources that you found and that you have just developed the center around? with Davis's work. How are you using that in the classroom and as a teaching tool now that you're in higher education?
Well, I take her primary sources, her diary entries, into the classroom, and I have students begin to talk about documenting their own life's history. I mean, here's Emilie Davis, whose name was not known before I published this book. She's one of the unknowns in history, and if it wasn't for the fact that somebody somewhere, a family member, maybe one of her children, maybe her husband, somebody saved those diaries. And that notion that they pass from hand to hand. We're talking 150 years. Yeah. That's like through the Civil Rights Movement, through Reconstruction, through the Nadir, and then the history of Black people. They kept getting passed along, and they ended up in my hand. And so I have my students take a look at these to talk about the importance of what it means to tell your own story. If Emilie's diaries had not have survived, her name would not have survived. I mean, there are hundreds of thousands of people who've come through history that we don't know anything about, who've lived very solid lives with agencies, but they never wrote anything that was saved. Maybe they weren't published in the newspaper. Maybe they weren't a speaker or a writer, so they passed away. And they only exist in the minds and hearts of the people who are related to them. Well, Emilie Frances Davis's diary survived. 3 years of diaries written from 1863 to 1865. Here you have a Black woman who chose to write about her own life every single day for 3 years, 30,000 words about her life. Well, that's pretty powerful. And so with the students looking at this, I also tell them that she's like the first modern day tweeter, right? Because you know, tweets are really short, and she kept a pocket diary. And a pocket diary only fits in the palm of your hand. And you only have a few sentences per day. So here she is with these few sentences per day charting her life. And if she can do it in a pocket diary, then surely you can do it as you put your life out on Facebook, you put your life out on Twitter. You save these pieces of yourself and you kind of put them together and form this story about who you are.
And even as you're teaching them how they can, it's comparable, and how they can make the connection between the pocket diary and the tweeting and the Facebook and all of that. Technology is such now that you can take and make sure that her diaries are going to be around for much longer by doing the digital piece for them. So talk a little bit about technology and primary sources and relating that to students.
Well, her diary entries have been digitized, so people can pull them down from Penn State, and they can take a look at the actual writings, her handwriting on paper. I think technology, and people say this all the time, technology is a game changer. Like when you think about the fact that we are documenting every aspect of our lives, it's both exciting and dangerous. And I say exciting because now we have this record, this permanent record. That's the part that's dangerous too. Because I think young people are delving into the pool of technology, but they don't quite know how to swim. And I don't think they know how to swim because we don't really know how to swim. That as someone who studies communication, when we talk about who it is that are technology dinosaurs, right? So my parents are dinosaurs. They've heard about technology. They may have a cell phone. They try to keep up with Facebook, but they are not intimately tied to it like my sons are. I mean, we're immigrants, right? So anyone in my generation, we're technology immigrants. We probably came to Facebook and having a computer late in life. I think I got my first computer, I may have been in my 20s. I was already working as a filmmaker then. And I remember AOL, the You Got Mail, right?
Yes, exciting.
Yeah, exciting to hear, like, oh, someone has sent me something. Now, of course, we have hundreds of thousands of emails that we don't open.
Exactly.
And we're frustrated with the You've Got Mail notion because you can't answer them all, right? But in the beginning, there was something very special about hearing the You've Got Mail or waiting for it to dial up. Okay, so we're immigrants. Well, our children, and this is that 15-year-old generation, you know, the millennials, the early, late end of the millennials, they're technology natives, right? So, you know, we're putting technology in the crib with them. I remember I was telling my students about the Facebook cube, and the cube hangs over the crib. And so the child reaches up, and if they kick the cube or hit the cube, it takes a selfie and it uploads it to your Facebook page. So now we can watch our children 24 hours a day, even when they're sleeping. But what they're building, which is the dangerous part of it, is a cyber footprint. And the cyber footprint goes very deep. If we start posting pictures of our children from the womb, I mean, those sonogram pictures, and then we post when they're first born. I mean, I've seen people posting one day old. And then we've seen this child grow up through technology, and they seamlessly weave their own life into their own Facebook page, into their own Instagram page, into their own form of technology and social media, well, they're never removed from it. And that's the dangerous part. People don't understand that technology is forever.
When you are teaching and feeling that way, and you have Davis's work, and you can show that the power of the written word, are you still able to make a case for that?
Well, I am. I actually require my students to keep a journal. And many of them absolutely hate it. Not an electronic journal. You actually have to write in your journal at least twice a week. You got to go out. You have to unplug. You have to take an artist walk. Mm-hmm. And you have to find a space where you can be yourself. And you write just about whatever you want. I mean, I believe in the power of journaling. I've been keeping journals since I was 12 years old. And my two sons, 15 and 13, both keep journals. That notion of just writing down what happened to you, being connected to the page in that way. I think the difference with, say, an Emily Davis and one of my students today is that I actually interpreted Emily Davis's story. So I don't quite know what she meant when she wrote something. When she talks about the men in her life, I don't know if she really felt for them or if it was something that was happening. When she talked about an event, I don't know if she was really there. I'm just going to take her word for it because I can't really prove that she was in the audience of a Frederick Douglass speech, for example. Mm-hmm. If she said she was there, I just took it to mean that she was there. Well, with technology, I can prove it now. So part of your story is you have to be accurate because someone can always find out. If you say you were at this Bernie Sanders speech 100 years into the future, they're going to be able to document that and check it out and make sure that the story you're telling is very truthful, which in ways for Emily Davis, she didn't have to contend with.
Do you connect use the technology to allow the students to create or recreate that interpretation of Davis's story?
Yes, I give them Davis's raw diary entry. And kind of on the first day, I have them take a look at it and they have to try to figure out what she was writing. I mean, Davis is a 19th century writer. Her writing is very hard to read. She does a lot of makeup spellings. I mean, she's spelling people's names the way she felt that day. She spells her own names three different times. I mean, in 1863, she's E-M-I-L-I-E, and by 1864, she's E-M-L-I-E, and by 1865, she's E-M-I-L-Y. So, I mean, she's doing it to herself. Right. So, of course, she's doing it to other people. Mm-hmm. So you have to kind of figure out what she was writing, and I give them a chance to work through that. And then the second stage is to take my interpretation, because it is just my interpretation, and compare it with your interpretation. Which one is correct? Is it my transcription or your transcription? What is she really talking about here? What is the meaning behind what she's saying? That's that way of intimately connecting with the text, getting inside of her writing and trying to figure out who was Emily Frances Davis, this freeborn woman with agency, mm-hmm. who thought her life was so important that it had to be recorded.
And that's the other piece about it for students to realize that everyone of color was not enslaved, everyone was not ignorant and unable to read and write, and women had a voice and had something to say. And there were women, maybe few, but there were women who went ahead and did that. And I love the way when she spelled her name three different times, depending on how she wanted to be addressed. So what was the reception in the academic community with your find?
Well, I remember when I was writing it, because I used the 1863 diary for my dissertation. And my committee, they kept saying, you've got something big here. Like, you've got something really powerful. Do you recognize what you have? You have only the fifth primary source that's been found written by a free black woman, by her own hand. Like, you've got something here. And this is going to be an amazing project. So we're going to help you to write your dissertation like a book. So that way, when you finish, you can then drop in 1864 and 1865, and you can move towards getting it published. When I graduated in 2009, I defended in 2009 and I walked in 2009. I then went to a conference in South Carolina, a historians conference, SAW, which is for the Southern Association of Women Historians. And I remember I was presenting and my advisor was there, Chris Lindenmeyer, who's now a dean at Rutgers. And she took me to meet this gentleman, Alex Moore. And he was an acquisitions editor at University of South Carolina Press. He heard me present, she introduced me, and he was signing me. Within a few weeks. He's like, we've got to get this. We got to get this source. So I then had to work on 64 and 65. And that took me until 2013. And then I sent it off to Henry Louis Gates, and he was one of my biggest endorsers mm-hmm. of the book. And we started getting all this amazing reception about this new primary source. And when it came out in 14, it won 2 book awards immediately. And it also helped me to win the Lifetime Achievement Award from the Progressive National Baptist Convention. This notion of being able to go back, find our history, and reconstruct the narrative about black women at that time, that they were not all enslaved. They did yeah. have a life. They cared about more than just the war. Exactly. I mean, she talked about dating. She talked about going to the wharf and getting ice cream. She was a seamstress. She was a domestic. I mean, she was 21. And so here's this first insight into free black Philadelphia from her eyes.
And from the eyes of a young woman, which may explain the 3 different spellings yes. Of the name. But this was so significant. What made you want to do the center? I mean, you've just taken it and just evolved it.
Well, I think that the Emily Frances Davis is probably my burning bush experience. I think that we all have those times as academicians, as parents, as historians, when you're recognizing that you are at a moment, you're at a moment in time, mm-hmm. when you need to make a decision about who you're going to be and the type of work you're going to produce. And when I was faced with Emily Frances Davis's diary, I said, this is something big for me. This work is going to change my life. That's what I thought. I don't know exactly what I meant by that, but I felt that that work was going to change my life. And I wanted to represent that, and I wanted to really be the person that could tell her story and help to shape her narrative. So out of that became my Center for Research in Education and Culture, because I started doing lesson plans about Emily Davis. I started teaching about what it means to have agency. And as I suspected back and when I first got them back in 2006, it has changed my life. I mean, mm-hmm. I've moved from being a classroom teacher, which I loved, of middle school, to now I'm a tenured professor. I started writing books coming out of that. Emily was my first book, and I've written more books since then. I have connected with the family of Emily Frances Davis, and they often tell me they want me to write the next step in the narrative, talking more about her brother-in-law and the White family, because Jacob White's family was very well known in Philadelphia. So that book has taken me all over the world. I mean, I say that Emily has been in conversations that I will never be a part of. She's gone to places that I will never be, but she has arrived. And her name is part of this new canon for the history of 19th century black women. It will never be erased.
It's important to you that you are making her known in elementary, junior high, and high school as well. So those students coming along, by the time they are at the academy, are aware of the breadth mm-hmm. of the experience of African Americans.
I mean, they know about Rosa Parks, and they know about Dr. King, and they know about, you know, Frederick Douglass, like the Big Six, right? Mary McLeod, but the Big Six they always teach during Black History Month. It's time to add new names to that, and not just Emily Davis. You know, Diane Nash and Fannie Lou Hamer, like there are names that need to be
Ella Baker,
to our historical legacy, to help them to understand who we are. Alice Dunbar Nelson, Charlotte Fortin, like we could go on when we talk about just black women specifically.
Yes.
Who have helped to kind of construct this fabric, this blanket that we call, you know, our American experience. And so now Emily's a part of that. And I think across the spectrum, her life is such a lens that can be used to look at free black Philadelphia in 1863. That cannot be denied.
One of the things that, let me know if you're interested in doing this for your students, when you go to conferences, because you're sought after as a speaker and a presenter, what are you thinking of to enable more individuals who don't know, who are outside of the academy, who don't know about her? Are there panels? Are you doing a documentary? are you engaging your students in research? How are you going to broaden this?
Well, I work with History Now out of Philadelphia, and they are an Emmy award-winning documentary film company. I mean, they do amazing work, and they've been doing a long series on Philadelphia, and I am their historian in residence, so I've been working with them for quite a few years, but they did a mini documentary on Emily that was maybe 7 to 8 minutes And they did, you know, historical reconstruction and reenactment, and they had actors in it. But this notion of telling Emilie's story. I've written op-eds about Emilie. I've shared her in K-12 environments. I had the lesson plans for K-16 teachers. I have students doing tweets about Emilie during that time of the year, and we're talking about her work. So I've done a lot to kind of push her beyond the academy, because I believe, and I feel very passionate about this, that my work does not remain or just belong in the academy. I do work because I want to speak to the history of my people, and I want to share this with all people. So it's not just being in one environment, just in the academic environment. I believe that as historians, we have that call to share our work everywhere. If that's K-12, if that's in, you know, an elderly folks home, if that's going to a homeless shelter, I mean, wherever I am invited to speak, I pack Emilie up, because Emilie talks about the importance of telling your own story. And if there's nothing I believe that people need more, is to be in control of their narrative, to not let them write your story for you.
Carter G. Woodson, I always say, not only is the founder of African American history, but also of public history.
Yes.
In the academy, it's 30 plus years old, but we know that public history started long before that.
Yes.
So exactly the passion that you have for this, that we have as public historians, history outside of the classroom, which has not always been well received, but now the narrative is different. It's what else are you doing? That's why I was asking, how do you get it out of the classroom? Because it's important now to bring in the population that's not sitting in a chair taking a course. What's your next move? What's on the horizon?
I guess I've gotten really passionate since Emilie was published in 2014. My work really shifted with the murder of Trayvon Martin. Mm-hmm. It really had a profound impact on my life, because I'm a mother of teenage boys who are 15 and 13 now. And I had thought prior to that, I guess my husband and I had thought, that we could kind of educate ourselves out of dangerous situations. We could live in the right community. We could send them to private school. We could make sure that they played the right sports and they were in the right environments, and we drove them everywhere they had to go, and that we would never be a part of what was happening in those dangerous parts of the city. And after the murder of Trayvon Martin and kind of the introduction of this notion of the Black Lives Matter, we realized that we were not doing enough, that we were protecting our boys and we should have been preparing them. And I kept thinking, well, I'm sure it's going to blow up. I don't know why I thought that, given the fact that my dad was involved in the civil rights movement. And I know that when the waves of wind start to change, it's not going to simply blow over. But I kept thinking that if we just hold tight and if we just kind of march, everything will work itself out. But it began this trend. And my son started kind of keeping the names. Mm-hmm. And by the time we got to Freddie Gray in Baltimore City, where we live, my son said, we have to do something. We have to march. And it was the birth of their activism. And I would maybe venture to say it kind of reignited my own. And that's when I published letters to my black sons. That's when I started speaking a lot, connecting the civil rights movement to Black Lives Matter. That's when I began going into K-12 environments, really talking about how we can prepare young people to have their own agency and their own voice, where I use Emilie as a lens. You must tell your own story. You must be in charge of that. What is the narrative that you are creating? What is the historical legacy that you're going to leave behind? And so my work has really been shaped by that. I have a new book of poetry coming out in 2 weeks, and it documents what's been happening in the country. It starts on the day that Eric Garner, which is July 7, 2014, when he was killed, and my sons challenged me. They said, Mommy, could you write a poem every day for the next year about what's happening around the world? And that was a huge challenge. We've been talking about Japanese art and this notion of creating art in the moment. And so it was a fun challenge, and I took it on. And so Race Brave is really the culmination of that work, just my 1 year document. And in that year, of course, you had Eric Garner, you had Sandra Bland, you had Freddie Gray. Like, so much happened in that year, the anniversary or the commemoration for Tamir Rice. And it was an amazing year and a hard year. And it was an emotional year when I started thinking about who I was as a mother and what is my job, not just to mother my own sons, but to mother all young boys and girls. How do we train ourselves to be race brave, to make sure that we're doing everything we can so that our children have the right to be free, to be alive, to have a future, to dream out loud? So that is the work that I'm doing. I want to sing Black Lives Matter until the whole world hears.
That's one of the things that historians, I believe, need to take on. We're more than just a narrow, selected field. We have to be in the moment. And so you're actually doing that. What is also interesting is the technology used in Black Lives Matter. Mm-hmm. I love the connection between the civil rights movement, but I believe they stand on the shoulders and they are going to go much further mm-hmm. with that foundation. The technology is their friend here. So how do you use the positiveness of the technology towards keeping the movement, documenting it, mm-hmm. validating it, mm-hmm. doing an authentic representation of what you're feeling and what you're, how you're involved in this whole movement?
It's interesting because when we started, you were talking about all the different fields I've been involved in. And I have always thought that at some point it was all going to come together. I would always say, well, I don't know why the Lord has opened up this door, but he's opened up this door. I'm going to go ahead and walk through it. I'm going to go ahead and be a filmmaker and see what happens. And I'll be a school teacher and see what happens. And I'll just do this and see what happens. But I feel that all those things have finally come together. Mm-hmm. Because now as a professor in communication in African and African American history, I know technology. And so I know how to connect with social media. I know how to use it to document our stories. When we were marching for Freddie Gray and I went into that community, I knew that I had skills I could add to that. I said, you know, I can record the story for you. I can get my iPad out. I can shoot clips. I can be a witness. I can document this. So I am intimately connected with using technology from my years in documentary film, my years in television production, which I'm able to draw upon those skills and now use them to help speak to this movement. I think the movement is intergenerational. And I think that instead of being, you know, that instead of the idea that we don't have any leaders in Black Lives Matter, that we'll lead a full, right? That everybody has a voice and everybody has a part to play. So what are your talents and how can you lend them to help us move this torch forward?
This is wonderful. We need to have you back. I'm looking forward to talking with you again further about uniting the technology, Black Lives Matter, and documenting what's happening in the present. Thank you for being with us today.
Thank you so much for inviting me.
If you would like to know more about Dr. Karsonya Whitehead, visit her website at kwisewhitehead.com. If you would like more information about the academic programs and events offered by the University of the District of Columbia, visit the university's website at www.udc.edu. If you would like to learn more about the many certificate and training programs offered by the University of the District of Columbia Community College, visit the website at www.cc.udc.edu. Thank you for watching. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber.